Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Sleighed, A Christmas Mystery by Yvonne Vincent, narrated by Angela Ness. Prologue. Vic Gazette, 23rd December. Diamonds are a laird's best friend. Record numbers of tourists have visited Vic this winter, attracted by the island's festive offerings, chief among them the largest diamond in Scotland, currently on display at Vic Castle. This boost in numbers is good news for Elsie's book club, with the charity set to receive half the profits from the display. The Christmas Star Diamond is said to have once belonged to Mary, Queen of Scots, and was gifted to William Dear, Earl of Marnach, by King James himself, shortly before his ascension to the English throne in 1603. Now the diamond's current owner, Laird Hamish Dear, has pledged to donate half the money raised from the display to the fundraising efforts of children from Port Vic Primary School. The remainder will be used for urgent renovations on the castle and its gardens. The Elsie's Book Club charity has so far distributed 5,000 books to schools and libraries throughout Scotland in a drive to keep the nation reading. Set up following the death of Port Vic librarian Elsie Reid, the charity restores old books, supports new authors, and gives books to the next generation of readers. High-profile supporters such as Hollywood legends Johnny Munro and Al Cappuccino have helped raise the charity's profile. Laird Hamish says, "It's a no-brainer. Elsie's Book Club keeps the past, present and future of Scotland alive. It's the real diamond here. The fundraising done by the local children over the past few months has been astounding, and we are thanking them with a party at the castle on Christmas Eve." Local shop owner Mrs. Hubbard, who was instrumental in expanding the charity following her friend's death, told the Gazette, "I can't believe it, dearie. We gave the Twitter a virus. It's so good of wee Hamish to chip in." Indeed, the charity's video, Read for Scotland, has gone viral, as has the number of visitors making the trip to see the Christmas star, making this a very merry season for all. Chapter 1. "I'll look ridiculous," wailed Penny, eyeing the candy-striped tights and green shorts suspiciously. "My thighs will look huge. I don't have a thigh gap. I have thigh muffins." "Stop stressing, woman," said Jim. "It's the school party. A bunch of 10-year-olds aren't going to be interested in your thighs. Anyway, I like your thigh muffins."
"Are you trying to say my thighs are fat?" asked Penny, her voice dangerously low.
No,
said Jim, his expression taking on a slightly hunted look.
"I was just saying that you will be the sexiest and most beautiful elf a Santa has ever had."
"Nice save, Santa. But why can't I be Mrs. Santa instead? Red is more my colour, don't you think?"
"We've been through this," Jim sighed. "Mrs. Hay has already hired the costume. Since she started cooking for Ernie on the other side, well, let's just say that there's an extra false teeth glass by her bedside now. I think she's planning on giving him the Christmas of his life. I suppose at 96, you have to make it count."
Jim clipped his belt below the pillow beneath his red suit and held his arms out.
"Maybe you and I could, you know, have a Merry Christmas."
Penny looked at the 6-foot beacon of obesity before her and decided that if he asked her to sit on his knee, she'd have to punch him. There really was no other choice.
"Do you need a hand with your beard?" she asked, changing the subject.
"How come when I ask you the same thing, you get all offended?"
Penny briefly wondered if she should bring the timing of that punch forward, but decided to ignore him and tackle the dreaded tights instead. She hated tights.
They were always either concertinaed around her ankles, or the gusset was so low that her knees sprung together after every step. She'd never find a pair that fit, including this pair, she thought, as she pulled the waist up to under her bra. Lordy, the makers of tights have a very strange idea of women. Is there a Mr. Denier out there somewhere, proudly walking around with a 7-foot-tall, size zero woman on his arm? And pockets, she silently ranted. Don't even get me started on why they don't make women's clothes with pockets. Like some sort of conspiracy between the makers of handbags and clothes. A weird symbiosis where the sales of one depend upon the deficiencies of the other. And we just accept it. Oh, and fake pockets. Yes, ridiculous, loathsome things. Never mind human rights and political outrage. Perhaps womankind should rise up and march on Parliament, demanding pockets and a good pair of tights. Jim regarded Penny anxiously. She looked quite annoyed. Maybe this wasn't the best moment to ask if she'd sit on his knee. Come to think of it, maybe this wasn't the best moment to mention that she'd put the tights on outside in and back to front. He could see the little label on the seam that ran up her belly and under her bra. By the time they were both dressed and ready to set off, Penny had worked herself up to planning a petition to make bra underwire illegal. She regarded herself in the mirror, scowling at her reflection, before jamming on the green elf hat with such fury that it slid over her eyes, the fur trim tickling her nose. And another thing, she declared, pulling off the hat and glaring at Jim. Why do men get trousers in a variety of lengths and we don't? Jim had no real answer for this. He just assumed that whatever was going on here must be his fault. So he decided that telling her she was right about everything was the safest course of action.
It's a scandal, he agreed. And I'll tell you what else you're right about. Your thighs look huge in those tights.
The bickering continued all the way outside to the car, faltering only when their words were carried away on the blasts of frigid air whipping in from the sea. Jim looked doubtfully at the slate sky, where clouds pregnant with snow hung ominously over the island.
We should take Phil,
he said, referring to the ancient Land Rover that had stood the test of potholed farm roads across the island.
But I've loaded everything into my car, Penny protested. All the presents for the children and the food that Mrs. Goggins asked me to pick up.
Okay, fine, but don't blame me if we get stuck in snow on the way back. Although, if we get stranded, at least we have a couple of thigh muffins to keep us going till morning.
Jim clocked Penny's pursed lips and held up his hands.
Just joking. Anyway, where are Eileen and Ricky? They should have been here by now.
Get yourself into the car and I'll call her. Penny left Jim trying to squeeze his pillowed belly into the front passenger seat while she called her friend. Eileen picked up on the first ring.
Hello, National Elf Service. Rudolph speaking.
If you're Rudolph, who am I? Asked Penny. The line went silent as Eileen thought for a moment.
Gandalf? She eventually declared.
Gandalf! Couldn't it be something a bit less beardy? I've had enough of Jim going on about my chin hair.
Nope, it's definitely Gandalf, because you're very wise and totally magic. Not like real magic, because that would be spooky, unless... You don't do spells, do you?
No, but if I did, I'd be casting a hurry-up spell on you.
Hint taken, and on my way, Gandalf. Did you get chocolate fingers?
For a split second, Penny thought that Eileen was still talking about spells. Then her brain caught up and she remembered the phone call from the castle cook yesterday. Apparently the chocolate fingers were a key component of Mrs. Goggins' Christmas tree centrepiece.
Bugger, I forgot, said Penny. We'll have to stop on the way.
10 minutes later, Penny pulled into the supermarket car park. Beside her, Jim was wedged into the passenger seat, the seatbelt straining against his belly.
I'm not going in for the chocolate fingers, he said. Took me 10 minutes to get the seatbelt on.
You could have removed the pillow and put it back on when we got to the castle, Penny pointed out. She looked in the rear-view mirror at her passenger. Eileen was suddenly very fascinated by the view of the recycling bins. Oh, for goodness sake, I'll go, Penny huffed. She got out of the car and stomped towards the supermarket entrance, the bells on her hat and shoes heralding her arrival. No wonder I'm in a bad mood today, she thought. I'm surrounded by inconsiderate gits. What a bloody kerfuffle for a Christmas party for 10-year-olds. When I was 10, we were happy with a game of musical chairs in the church hall. But no, this lot had to go and get themselves on the local news for raising loads of money for charity. And Laird Hamish Bloody Deer, the biggest inconsiderate git of them all, has to throw a bloody party for them at the castle. Gits, gits, gits. Penny threw a filthy look at the startled security guard who, unused to seeing elves in his shop, had stopped picking his nose for long enough to gawp. He discreetly fingered the hem of his blazer, trying to dislodge a bogey from under his fingernail, then gave Penny a cheeky wink and crooned, Have your elf a merry little Christmas. Ignoring him, she stalked into the shop, intent on locating the chocolate fingers and getting out of there as soon as possible. She was well aware that she looked ridiculous. When she'd agreed to help out, she thought that Hamish meant her to chaperone the kids or give Mrs. Goggins a hand with the food. It was only when Jim had turned up with the costumes that she realised she and Eileen would be his little helpers. Little? Humph. More like Santa's solid little helper. She'd put on half a stone in the past week from comfort-eating her way through a tin of Quality Street that she'd ostensibly bought for Christmas Day. She knew she was being entirely unreasonable in grumping about the party and her costume. What she was really angry about was the fact that Alex Moon, a.k.a. the ex-husband, a.k.a. Chief Wank Puffin of the Clan McTwat Doodle, had insisted on having the twins with him in London for Christmas, and her little cherubs had gone without a backward glance. She'd dropped them off at Aberdeen Airport a few days before, trying to look happy as she waved goodbye, while all the time seething inside and wondering if it was bad parenting to dial in an anonymous tip to the airport police that Hector and Edith Moon were carrying drugs. They weren't, of course, but by the time the police had completed a full cavity search, the plane would be long gone, and they'd have to come home to Mummy. Fortunately, common sense had kicked in, and she'd made do with adding Hector and Edith to her list of gits. Even though she loved them very much indeed, most of the time. Penny took a few deep breaths and tried to push the reset button on her mood. Focus on the here and now, she told herself. Think of the positives. First Christmas with Jim, the twins would have a great time in London, and, best of all, her mother wasn't cooking Christmas dinner this year. Instead, along with Eileen's family, they were all going to Jim's dad's house. Ivor Space was a dab hand in the kitchen, and, unlike her mother, didn't insist on tartar sauce with the turkey. Righty, ho ho ho, mood restored. Now, where do they keep the chocolate fingers? Penny jingled her way through the shop, only dimly aware of the astonished looks from other shoppers. She was on the biscuit aisle, debating whether buying and eating an entire box of Family Circle on your own could be excused on the grounds that it was Christmas, when she heard the tannoy spring into life. Bing bong! This is an elf and safety announcement for customers. There's a little sprite on the floor in aisle four, so please watch your mistletoes. Penny moved along a few feet. Perhaps she'd resist the Family Circle. Ooh, what about a box of Deans? She really liked. Bing bong! Another alert for aisle four. We apologise to customers wishing to purchase Deans shortbread. A very elfish customer has taken the last box. Penny looked around her. She was beginning to suspect that something was amiss.
Carefully, she put the box of Dean's back and continued scanning the biscuits for chocolate fingers. Ah, there they were, right at the top. If she stood on tiptoe, she might just be able to reach. Stretch, Penny. Nope, it was no use. She'd have to stand on something.
Bing bong, manager to aisle four, please. There's an elf on the shelf.
Penny swiped two boxes of chocolate fingers neatly into her basket and headed to the checkout. Even at the 10 items or less till, there was a large queue. She stood, impatiently tapping a belled foot, while baskets were unloaded onto the belt and the little plastic next customer baton at the front was passed back down the line in an ultra-polite supermarket relay. The woman behind the till was rendered sallow by the harsh strip lighting, and her eyes bore dark circles that spoke of a day spent dealing with an unrelenting flow of shoppers. Even the tinsel hung from a pole behind her, sagged miserably from a single piece of sticky tape, its once jaunty loops now slumped between two checkouts, like a shiny garrote poised to catch the unwary shopper. All around was hustle and bustle as the islanders stocked up for Christmas, like Seventh-day Adventists facing a month of Saturdays. What is it about the human race, Penny wondered, that we can abstain from visiting a supermarket for a week, surviving on out-of-date tins of soup because we're too lazy to do the big shop? Yet when the supermarket is closed for one day, we are driven to buy 20 pints of milk, 5 loaves and enough toilet roll to wipe the bums of Belgium. She finally shuffled to the front of the queue and glanced towards the customer service desk, where Eileen's brother-in-law, Robbie Bates, was leaning over a microphone.
Bing bong, security to checkout number one, please. A customer is trying to pay with jingle bills.
Robbie flashed her a cheeky grin and winked. In response, Penny discreetly raised a middle finger and scratched her eyebrow.
Felt like? Robbie asked, catching up with her once she'd paid. Are you off to Laird Hamish's shindig at the castle?
Aye, we have about 20 10-year-olds to entertain. Eileen and I are helping Santa. Mrs. Hubbard's telling them a Christmas story in honour of Elsie, which is a nice touch, and Sandra next door is in charge of discipline.
Are Fiona and Gordon not going? Fiona helped organise the fundraising, didn't she?
They bowed out. The baby's due soon, and I think Fiona's using every spare minute to clean the cottage.
Robbie grimaced. They may as well make the most of it. It'll be the last time the place is clean and tidy for the next 18 years. Hi, I hope Hamish has given you a wee look at the Christmas star. I haven't been up to see it myself yet, but I was going to take the wife in the new year, once the fuss has died down.
Yeah, I haven't seen it yet either, said Penny. I'm really looking forward to a private viewing.
Enjoy the party. If Eileen's away, I might take a bottle of whiskey and a permanent marker round to Kenny and see if we can beat Ricky and Gervais's high scores on the PlayStation.
I don't think the whiskey will help with the scores, said Penny doubtfully.
Maybe no, but it sends Kenny straight to sleep, and me and the kids are dab hands at drawing handlebar moustaches. Eileen will think she's married to Poirot by the time we're done.
Penny wondered whether to warn her friend that the family photos would be a little different this Christmas, but decided to let Robbie have his fun. She returned to the car, clipped on her seatbelt, and turned to smile at Jim and Eileen. Sorry for being an old grumpy pants. I actually have a good feeling about this party. Great food, dancing, and Santa. What more could you want? It's going to be perfect. Chapter 2. Penny parked by what would once have been the servants' entrance to Vic Castle, but was now merely Laird Hamish and Lady Carr's back door. The gravel drive narrowed into a path which led to Hamish's pride and joy, his gardens. In the spring and summer months, the neat beds were a burgeoning riot of glorious colour. Now, however, they were iced with a fine frosting of the snow which, if it continued to fall, would soon form an undulating shroud, turning the plants and low bushes into mysterious lumps in the dimming late afternoon light.
Jim once more looked to the heavens. I think we're in for a fair bit of snow. I'll ring Randy Mayer and ask him if he can ply the castle road with his tractor before the end of the party.
Surely it can't get that bad in the space of a couple of hours, said Penny, unloading a box of goodies from the boot.
Oh, it can, Eileen assured her. Kenny and I took the boys to Santa's grotto at the loch a few years ago. It started snowing as we left, and by the time we drove home a couple of hours later, you could see the flashes of the power lines coming down under the weight of the snow. We barely made it back before the time got cut off.
Penny smiled wistfully and gazed across the gardens, thinking back to the winters of her childhood, where numb fingers were soon warmed by a mug of her mum's hot chocolate.
I suppose you forget what it's like when you've been living in London, she mused. Half a centimetre of snow down south and the whole place grinds to a halt. Plus it was different when we were kids. Do you remember sledging down Randy's field on an old car bonnet? About 10 of us piled one atop the other, taking it in turns to be on the bottom.
Aye, said Jim sourly. The school was closed for a week and my dad made me stay in and do homework.
Eileen sighed, her eyes following Penny's gaze past the lawn to the snow-tipped hedges.
That was the year Kenny wrote, I love you, in the snow. It was so romantic.
It was yellow snow, Penny reminded her.
Still, it was quite a long sentence, and he even put a wee love heart on the end.
We being the operative word, Penny laughed. It was Jim's turn to look wistful as he chuckled and said,
that laddie could pee the whole alphabet. What a legend.
The sound of a throat being cleared behind them made them turn. Mrs. Goggins, dressed in a fresh apron and Ugg boots, was helping herself to two bulging carrier bags from the boot.
You can stand out here in a dwam and freeze all day, or you can help me in with these and put the kettle on, she said by way of greeting.
And happy Christmas to you too, Mrs. Goggins, said Penny. Jim and Eileen grabbed the remainder of the bags and they followed Mrs. Goggins into the enormous castle kitchen. The first thing that hit them was the smell of fresh baking, clean, warm and floury, with just a hint of nutmeg. If I had a granny, thought Penny, this is what her hugs would smell like. She and Jim had been frequent visitors to the castle since solving the mystery of the Laird's ladle. Of course, Jim was already friendly with Hamish, but she had found an unexpected ally in Cara, who had joined Penny's weight loss group, Losers Club, claiming that she needed to shift a couple of pounds, even though she was impossibly slim and glamorous. Penny suspected that Cara was simply lonely, so had taken her under her wing. Over the past few months, the two women had helped Mrs. Hubbard administer the book restoration charity set up by the older woman's best friend, Elsie, shortly before her death. Thanks to a combination of Cara's contacts, Penny's determination, and Mrs. Hubbard's ability to blackmail almost anyone into submission, important historical documents were rescued from mouldering oblivion and now took pride of place in both the museum and the castle, where they enriched the story of the island. As someone with no past beyond her parents, the older Penny became, the more she valued her connection to Vic. Despite her adolescent drive to escape the place and carve out her future in the world across the water, she now realised that the island was in her very bones.
If you want to daydream, shift your lazy bum out of my kitchen, or you can make yourself useful and help me with those volley vents, said Mrs. Goggins, handing Penny an apron.
Right, volley vents, said Penny, eyeing the tray of tiny pastry cases. What do you need me to do? The next hour was spent stuffing and icing and slicing and screeching as fingers were burnt and hundreds of tiny pastries and cakes were transferred from ovens to the plates, which soon covered every available surface. Sandra next door and Mrs. Hubbard arrived, and Mrs. Goggins put them straight to work on what she called things on sticks. Under her watchful eye, they soon had a banquet fit for any discerning 10-year-old with an aversion to vegetables and an eye for carbs. Disco Bob passed through, lugging the huge case which contained his DJ equipment. His attempt to swipe a sandwich on the way by was quickly thwarted by Mrs. Goggins, who delivered a sharp rap to the knuckles with the fish slice she'd just used to decant a pizza from the oven. He yelped and put his hand to his mouth, sucking the sting and glaring defiantly at the stern cook.
"Who knows where your mucky fingers have been?" she told him. "Probably all over other people's belongings. I don't know what Laird Hamish was thinking of, letting you within 100 feet of the castle, especially with the Christmas star here. Well, you better keep your fingers to yourself, and I'll be keeping my eye on you."
Disco Bob ran a nervous hand through his thinning dark hair and said,
"That was then, and this is now. Laird Hamish, may God bless him, believes in giving people second chances."
Mrs. Goggins snorted disbelievingly.
"Aye, and I believe a leotard doesn't change its spots." "A leopard! It's a leopard that doesn't change its spots!"
Mrs. Goggins drew herself up to her full 5'2" and angrily shook the fish slice at him.
"I thought you'd find God in prison, yet here you are, being rude about the afflicted. For centuries, those poor people were thrown out of their communities and... leopard, big spotty cat," said Disco Bob, raising his voice to cut off Mrs. Goggins' rant, just as she reached full flow.
"Nonsense. Why would we be comparing people to leopards? Leotards make far more sense. Now, go and get your disco set up in the big hall. The children will be here any minute."
Disco Bob shuffled off with his giant case, muttering darkly about how leotards made absolutely no sense. A moment later, they heard him swearing loudly as his case became stuck on the narrow, winding stone staircase. Jim decided to spare the poor man another telling off by rushing to help unwedge the thing and manoeuvre it the rest of the way. Mrs. Goggins turned to Penny, Eileen, Sandra next door and Mrs. Hubbard.
"If you help me take these plates upstairs, there should be time for a wee look at the Christmas star before the children arrive."
Within half an hour, the four women were slumped in chairs, looking on in astonishment as the tiny figure of Mrs. Goggins dashed upstairs with what must be her 20th load of plates.
"I don't think I can take another step, dearie," panted Mrs. Hubbard. "How on earth Imelda Goggins manages all these stairs at her age, I'll never know."
"How old is she?" asked Sandra next door. "She's one of those people who seem timeless."
501, said Eileen with a wry grin. "She's probably been here since the castle was built in 1521.
"That school trip all those moons ago wasn't wasted then," said Penny.
"Nah, she's been using up the... what's the French word for napkins? The... wibliates they bought for the 5th centenary celebrations last year."
Hearing footsteps on the stairs, the women sat up straight, fully anticipating a lecture on slackers and scoundrels from the rather stern cook. Instead, a pair of shiny brogues appeared, followed by the man himself, Lord Hamish Dear, Laird of Vic. His face was red and shiny, and his eyes sparkled with excitement. He was wearing a kilt in the black watch tartan and a green T-shirt which proclaimed him to be the world's sexiest laird.
"An early Christmas present from Cara," he said, following Penny's gaze towards his chest. "I'll change it before the kids get here, but it was a bit of fun while we put up the Christmas decorations in the big hall."
"I thought you already had decorations in there," said Penny.
"Aye, the posh visitors' decorations. These are the family ones. We always put them up on Christmas Eve once the staff and tourists are gone. You can't beat a good paper chain and the wonky angel that rain made in primary school. We were going to wait until after the party, but I thought it would make the kids feel at home if it was all a bit more personal."
"That was very thoughtful. Have you met Eileen, Mrs. Hubbard and Sandra next door before?" said Penny, gesturing to her friends, who had somehow staggered to their exhausted feet to greet their host.
"Ah, Minty,"
said Hamish, pulling the older woman into an embrace.
I need to talk to your Douglas about the posters for the craft fair in the village hall.
He's a genius with a slogan,
wheezed Mrs. Hubbard, her eyes bulging as Hamish squeezed a little too tightly.
I was Hamish's nanny before we bought the shop, she explained to the others once he'd released her. I bet he still doesn't clean his teeth properly.
Hamish flashed her a wide smile and said,
No fillings, Mrs. H. You taught me well. Now, who is this gorgeous creature with the big hair?
Sandra next door patted her lacquered blonde bob, then giggled in a most un-Sandra-like fashion as he gallantly kissed her hand before moving on to Eileen.
I believe you're the elf who dived into my septic tank to rescue your coat about 30 years ago, he said, raising an eyebrow.
Eileen sank into a deep curtsy and peered up at him through her thick lashes.
Pleased to meet you, Your Majesty, and sorry about that, Your Majesty. My sandwiches were in the pocket.
Hamish's lips twitched, and Penny could see him struggling to maintain his composure as he helped Eileen up and said,
Never has my septic tank been graced with such perfumed beauty.
Thank you very much, Your Majesty. People do say that.
What about you jumping into their septic tanks?
Eileen reddened.
No, I mean, they like my perfume.
Ah, right, said Hamish. Glad to hear you don't make a habit of... never mind. What about a private viewing of the Christmas star before the sprogs show up, eh?
He led them upstairs, explaining,
It's said that if the Christmas star leaves the dear family, then the heir will suffer a painful death. Each laird leaves a will forbidding the next from selling it. So, no matter how skint we are, the bugger has to stay in a vault in Edinburgh. Otherwise, the heir dies a painful death and the diamond reverts to the crown. I was going to display it for the quincentenary, but the insurance was too high. I've managed to hire a couple of security guards to do night shifts this time, though, which has brought the cost down. Ridiculous, really. The thing's in an alarmed case that hooks up to the mainland and the local police. I mean, we're on an island, for God's sake. Who's going to steal it? The minute the alarm goes off, they shut down any transport links and the thief's trapped. Good to know, said a voice at the top of the stairs. Nothing safe around Penny. She's a master burglar.
Ha, bloody ha, Jim, said Penny. Where have you been?
I was helping Disco Bob set up. That's some piece of kit he's got there. Mind you, complete overkill for a kid's party. By the way, Hamish, Cara wants you to help her hang a disco ball from the chandelier. I offered, but she said she couldn't be bothered with the paperwork if I had an accident. Whereas you, my friend, are worth a fortune to her dead. Then let us beat a hasty retreat through to the display room, said Hamish, pulling aside a tapestry to reveal a hidden door. We'll take the exciting route, secret passageway shortcut. Castle's riddled with them.
Frowning, Mrs. Hubbard said, I hope you told the security company about them, dearie, although this explains why I could never find you when it came to bedtime.
Don't worry, we gave everyone a map of the castle with all the passageways and tunnels clearly marked. Well, the ones that we know about.
Insulated by thick walls from the fireplaces and radiators that kept the main areas of the castle warm, the narrow passageway was chilly and Eileen whispered,
Proper ghosty territory.
Eileen was endlessly fascinated by the occult,
the spiritual, conspiracy theories and aliens.
In fact, thought Penny, if Jeannie Campbell was anything like her daughter in her younger days, it's little wonder she got caught up in a cult. It's a pity she turned into a fierce old bag, albeit one with a heart of slightly tarnished silver. Penny hoped that Eileen wouldn't follow in her mother's footsteps, although with her friend's air of innocent happiness, enduring well into her 40s, there was little chance of that happening. Hamish suddenly stopped at a door with a keypad, and everyone crowded in behind him as he tapped in a code.
The keypad gave an ominous single bleep. He tried again, with the same result. "Bugger," he said. "Only one more try and we're locked out. I was sure it was Cara's birthday." "What have you been putting in?" asked Penny, peering at her phone. 2583. Try 3582. Hamish input the digits and they heard a click.
"How on earth did you know that?" he asked,
pushing the door open. "Because I have her details from when she joined Losers Club."
"Aren't there laws about sharing personal details?" asked Hamish.
"How about a deal? If you don't tell on me, I won't tell your wife that you forgot her birthday."
"Fair enough. Can we move along?" said Sander next door from the back of the line. "I'm stuck behind Jim and I'm getting claustrophobic." "Good one, Sander next door. Claustrophobic," said Jim. "Don't worry, we have private elf care."
Sandra next door looked at him like he'd just asked her to roller skate naked down Main Street.
"I'm actually claustrophobic, you fool. I'm feeling quite faint."
"Ah, Hamish, hurry up. Sandra's not feeling like herself."
The line of people shuffled forward and Sandra next door breathed a sigh of relief as she walked through the door into a large wood-panelled room at the centre of which stood a glass case on a plinth. The group fanned out and her sigh of relief turned to a gasp of awe. There, sparkling on a purple cushion, was the largest diamond in Scotland.
"It's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen," Sandra next door whispered, her tone devoid of its usual bitter sarcasm.
"Well, bugger me with a ball of tinsel. My flabber is gasted," said Jim.
"The glass could do with a wee polish," said Mrs. Hubbard, reaching into her cavernous handbag and pulling out a bottle of something blue and a cloth.
She stepped forward, aiming the bottle at the glass, and was just about to spray when Hamish shouted,
"No!
It just needs a bit of elbow grease, dearie," said Mrs. Hubbard.
"No!"
exclaimed Hamish, his voice an octave higher than its normal deep baritone.
"It's alarmed. You'll have the whole island shut down and the place swarming with police. So, no grease, please, and no elbows."
"Can I help you, sir?"
said a voice from the main doorway.
"It's okay," said Hamish, sounding harassed. "Mrs. Hubbard was just... Never mind. Everyone, this is Noel Bowes, one of the security guards I was telling you about."
Beside her, Penny could hear Jim snickering. She gave him a sharp poke in the pillow, ignoring his whispered,
"No elbows. That's pure class."
Noel sidled into the room, followed by another man. Both were as tall as basketball players, had identical buzz cuts, and wore the blue uniforms of security guards. Under normal circumstances, they were probably quite intimidating. But in the presence of the man who paid their wages, they removed their caps and adopted an obsequious air. Hamish introduced the slightly shorter giant as Jack Hughes, a former soldier from Bucky. His slow, broad northeast accent contrasted with Noel's nasal Glaswegian whine, and Penny was relieved that there was a way to tell them apart. Not that she'd probably need to, but not getting people mixed up was surely a common courtesy. After all, look what happened when her mother sexted Len Harper, the chairman of the golf club, instead of Len Hopper, her husband. Penny's father had had to disable Mary's phone camera and write a letter of apology. Mr. Harper had, of course, demanded that Mary write the letter, but she'd learned the emojis by that stage and simply responded by texting him all the rude ones she knew. That was Mary all over, unashamed and unapologetic, unless she deemed it truly warranted. Sometimes Penny wished she could be more like her mother. Mary Hopper would have told Alex where to go when he asked to have the twins for Christmas, and to hell with the consequences. Instead, the upright streak of decency that Penny had inherited from her father triumphed, and she gave in without a fight. Nevertheless, a tiny defiant spark of the Mary in her hoped they all had a rotten time, and the twins decided that never again would they spend Christmas with their dad.
Oh, Penny, she told herself, you're definitely on the naughty list.
What you thinking about, Gandalf?
Eileen whispered.
It'd better be making Jim get something the size of that thing set into an engagement ring.
Penny rolled her eyes. Could I please have a name that's a bit more classy? What about Elvish Presley?
Nope, Rudolf and Gandalf are more Christmassy.
How is Gandalf Christmassy?
He's magic,
Eileen hissed, as if it were obvious.
And he has a beard. Beards are Christmassy. Sorry, Gandalf, but you're Gandalf, and that's the end of it.
It's not the end of it. I'm Elvish Presley.
Gandalf.
Are you Gandalf? Whispered Jim. No, I'm Elvish Presley.
Aye, well, you don't have the hips for Elvish, but you've definitely got the Gandalf thing going on.
Jim rubbed his chin and winked at her. Before Penny could respond, Hamish announced that they should leave because the children would be arriving soon. With a last backward glance at the diamond, the party obligingly followed him through the main door and down to the big hall, where Cara was waiting with mulled wine and chocolates.
I just have one last thing to do,
he told his wife, giving Penny a knowing wink, before wandering off, muttering about changing that damn door code. Chapter 3.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.